Hello, and thank you for being here to everyone who are listening and joining in this beautiful encounter. I would like to extend a big thanks to Mara for inviting me to contribute to this year's summer school. My name is Daniela Ramos Arias, and I am a curator from Costa Rica living and working in Bergen. In today's presentation, I will share some thoughts about my practice as a curator. I will also present two important projects that have shaped the direction I took into art mediation, which are the Education and Mediation Platform for the Bergen Assembly 2019 and Translating Togetherness, the mediation program at Hordaland Kunstsenter. As I mentioned before, I am a curator from Costa Rica living and working in Bergen, Norway. I am also an artist, a cultural manager, an organizer, and a producer. I run two organizations in Bergen that have a strong focus on collaboration: Art Folk and Shoskin. I run this with other colleagues, so it's not only me running everything. I also work freelance in different projects and institutions in and outside of Norway. In 2019, I was head of education and mediation for the Bergen Assembly, which is the triennial based here in Bergen, Norway. And right now I am part of the curatorial team at Hordaland Kunstsenter, an artist-run gallery with a regional reach in the city of Bergen. For the past 4 years, my main interest has been to create connections and points of communication with people outside of the arts community in Bergen, where I live, and offer alternative entry points to contemporary art. I understand art mediation as a process of exchange, as a process of exchange in points of view and knowledge. I believe it should not be exclusive to one person, the mediator or the educator, or one single department, the education department or the mediation department. Instead, it should be integral to a cultural institution. As I see it, mediation lives in the structures and the architecture of the spaces: the spaces of rest, the spaces of action, the non-spaces, the light, the sound. It lives in the texts used to communicate with the audiences, in the context that we're living, in the people that are hired. Who are we speaking to, and who are we hiring to reflect on our communities? In the communication and social channels, what kind of language and images are being used through social media, website, and newsletters, for example? On the way teams and co-workers interact, on the mandate, on the planning, on the programming, and the responsibility taken towards different communities. Mediation is also a meeting point between everything that is produced within these institutions and the people that come to them. I believe mediation goes hand in hand in the curatorial, and in my case, it is a focus point. As a curator, mediation practices are my primary interest. I am now going to start my slides, so bear with me. So my journey into art mediation has been nourished by the work of very dear colleagues and mentors. I am going to mention three that have been crucial to my practice. Maria Acaso introduced me to the field of art mediation and art and education through her books, research, and numerous conversations. Maria Acaso is a cultural producer whose projects center on defying the divisions between art and education, the academic and the popular, the theoretical and the practical, on developing contemporary education and transforming the formats of knowledge transmission. She is a founding member of the Invisible Pedagogies Collective, and Maria is head of education at Museo Reina Sofia in Madrid. Maria introduced me to the next group of people, the Empathic Pedagogies Network, which is made by an extensive group of colleagues that work in the field of art and education, mediation, and social practices in Latin America and Spain, and now Poland and Norway as well. This has brought me closer to my cultural background, as well as the work that has been produced in this field in other parts of the world. And the third person I want to introduce is Anne Scheffer Carlsen, who is a curator, writer, and editor, as well as an educator based in Norway. They currently run the MA in curatorial practice at the University of Bergen. And I have had the privilege of also being their student the past 2 years as I recently graduated from this program. To better give you an insight to the way I work, I will present, as mentioned earlier, two projects that are very dear to me and that are a reference to the way I continue to practice. And regarding all the links that I have shown you so far, I can share those later on and you can all have them if you wish. To start, I'm going to present my work at the Bergen Assembly 2019. In 2019, I had the opportunity to run the Education and Mediation Platform for the Bergen Assembly, where I had the chance to collaborate with incredible colleagues and mentors such as artist and educator Stacey Brayfield and the Spanish collective Pedagogías Invisibles. You can find Stacey co-running the amazing project IRL Bergen. She doesn't currently have a personal personal website, but you can follow her work here. And you can also see the work of Pedagogías Invisibles following that link. Together with Stacey and Pedagogías Invisibles, we designed an ambitious, active, and engaging mediation strategy, which was a reference to what my MA project later became. At the Bergen Assembly, I tested, failed, and succeeded. Different formats where empathy, people, and learning together were at the center of the practice. Tools such as walking together, having a conversation partner, sharing something to eat, and time for reflection came from this experience. These are tools that I carry with me and that I pass on to the next projects I work on. The Bergen Assembly 2019 had the title Actually, the Dead Are Not Dead, and was conceived by an interdisciplinary group of people led by the conveners Hans D. Christ and Iris Dressler, and in collaboration with a core group, which were Murat Deha Oduroglu, Banu Senetoglu, Maria Garcia, Hiwa Kay, Katia Krupenikova, Victor Neumann, Paul Preciado, Pedro G. Romero, Simon Sik, and Emma Walukau Wanangwa. To tell a bit about our experience, we came quite late into the project, so we had little time to produce our program and also very little funding. When we came, things were not yet clear, so we wanted to create a program that would function regardless of what would be presented. It would be a program focused on the local audience and would function as an alternative entry point to the different parts of the exhibition. We knew we wanted to be present, hands-on, and think of ourselves as facilitators that would encourage the audiences to ask questions and engage in different ways with us, with each other, with the exhibition, and the local context. We embraced from the very beginning the aspect of slowness and allowing each person to absorb at their own rhythm. With the use of some tools such as walking, drawing, listening, touching, making, asking, eating, talking, making use of the space, we engaged with the works presented and the people that joined us during the time of the triennial. Our contribution to the program had four projects that happened weekly during the 10 weeks of the Bergen Assembly. First, I'm going to tell you about Imagined Futures project, which was a program directed to schools and high schools together, focusing on intergenerational learning processes between children and adolescents. Together with our visitors, we developed a series of workshops inside of the exhibition space that would encourage this intergenerational interaction, conversation, and collaboration. Through this project, kids and adolescents worked together. They had conversations, they asked questions and answered them together. They were peers regardless of their age difference, each giving each other their own perspective in life. The next of the projects I will present is the School of Questions, and unfortunately for this I do not have documentation, but I will leave this image here, which belongs to the Imagine Futures project, but can connect well with the way Stacy worked. The School of Questions was led and designed by my colleague Stacy Brayfield, and it was offered every Tuesday after work after school. This was a platform for learning and research within the Bergen Assembly, open to anyone regardless of skills, age, or experience. The School of Questions turned this notion of a school upside down to focus on questioning rather than providing any answers. Then the next project is Thursday and Saturday Walks, and this was a project that I designed and developed on my own. This took a starting point with the idea of the guided tour at a gallery or museum, but participants were invited to join a specially devised walks that drew upon the concepts of the Bergen Assembly. Together with me as their guide, participants followed a choreographed route, looking at and discussing individual works and speculating on their interconnections. Often there was a guest or guests that were connected to the Bergen Assembly, either a contributor, part of the administration, a member of the core group, or production, which gave a focus to the conversation and introduced the visitors to the exhibition from within. In here, you can see us walking through the city to reach one of the exhibition venues. And one of the core members, Avi Garavi, was giving us a tour. Here, I am in conversation with core group member Emma Walukau Wanambwa, and she invited a collective called the Creators of Oi, which is a young group of people of color that live in Bergen, and they have been asking questions and reflecting on how it is to be a person of color in Bergen. After each walk, we gathered in Belgien, which was a space in the Bergen Assembly open for people to come and sit and reflect and think or just rest. Belgien was a place where we could sit around a table, have something to eat, share our experience and talk. This was a crucial part of each walk, having time together and time for conversation, all on the same level, on the table, digesting. The next of the projects is map making, which was developed and designed by Stacy and I together. And it was a mediation workshop program for families and individuals bringing together people of all ages. So this was also focused on an intergenerational collaboration. Most cases it was parents or grandparents with children, and they would work and investigate and research together in the space. Within the workshops, the participants would be making maps in different forms. For example, maps of conversations, hand-drawn maps, mapping traces of our footsteps, and maps that were made in response to and with specific elements of the exhibition, thinking of a map as a very wide concept. In this case, children and families or parents were instructed to go around the exhibition and find elements they found interesting, and photograph them, and later they would show us their photo gallery and tell the rest of the group what they thought and they meant or what they thought they were. So they were photo documenting and then sharing and mediating their own experience. In here, we're immersed in a immersive part of the exhibition where the artists are present, and this is a role-playing game where kids and parents are playing, they joined and played together just as the rest of the people could. But this was a children version, a shorter version, so this was the way we were mapping the exhibition, by playing Third, we were looking at the work of Hiwa K and one of his videos where he made a sculpture made with mirrors and walked through the city using the mirrors as to show how we can feel out of balance as migrants and his experience as a migrant. So in this case, we invited families to make their own devices with the mirrors and walk around the park, testing them. And together we would reflect about how the instability of not knowing where next step will go. So it was a very nice process of making these sculptures as well as testing them and talking about what it means to not feel connected to a place where you're at. So now I'm going to move on to the next project, which is Oversettelser av fellesskap, translating togetherness, traduciendo estar juntos. Sorry, I just forgot to say before the slide went too fast. But yes, as you can see, the Bergen Assembly, it was an extremely intense and full program developed mostly by only two people. So we were there weekly, developing, producing, and actually with the audiences. And there were three activities per week. So it was exhausting, but very exciting. And we learned a lot. With the exception of the schools program, which had three very valuable mediators who designed and produced and did their own mediation strategies, the rest was done by Stacy and I. So very exciting, but very intense. But yes, now moving on to the next project, translating togetherness. You can see the website of Kunstsenter, which is the space where it has been produced. Translating togetherness is the chosen title for this project in English. In Norwegian is Oversettelser av fellesskap, in Spanish, traduciendo estar juntos. Each of these translations has small nuances in meaning. Something is lost in the translation. As the title adapts to a new language, there is a slight change in the way we perceive it. And this is something that I find very valuable and responds well to the concept of the project and the concept of translation itself. Translating Togetherness is a mediation program at Hordaland Kunstsenter during 2020 and 2021, which consists of a series of gesture and encounters, workshops, letters, and conversations. It has been an initiative to create a stronger connection between the art center and its local surroundings. Translating Togetherness presents alternative ways of experiencing the exhibition program, as well as creating opportunities for the institution to interact and get better acquainted with the people living in the neighborhood where the project is situated. It has also been a way of looking at the concept of mediation as something that should be a part of an infrastructure in an arts institution. The program explores already existing methodologies in art mediation developed in Latin America that respond to the questions, how do we create communities in times of social distance? How do we create opportunities to meet, talk, and experience together? These methodologies are then translated and adapted to our Norwegian context by artists living and working locally. The program consisted of four projects. Some are visible and open to the public, while others go inwards towards the institution. The five projects are Coffee with the Team, sorry, the four projects are Coffee with the Team, Nurnes Strolls, Workshops with Noam Edelman Shatil, and Dear Neighbor or Kjære Nabo. The concept of translating has always been at the core of the project. To translate is not only to change words into a new language, it means also to change something into a new form. In this case, I take examples of mediation models developed in Latin America, and with the help of local collaborators, we develop new proposals that can respond to the context that we're in. The first of the projects I'm going to present is Coffee with the Team. And this has been a mediation project towards the institution, which means it's invisible to the audience, but it is internal process that helps the way teams work. This means that it has been internal, done with the team members of Hordaland Kunstsenter. You can see Cecilie, Vera, Carol, Petra, Robin, and Matthijs. Matthijs with the computer is the director of the institution. And we're missing some of the members, but you know how it is. The project draws from the teamwork at Teoretica, an art institution based in San Jose, Costa Rica, which promotes, disseminates, encourages, and develops research on artistic practices in Central America and the Caribbean. Teoretica has a team of three directors that see each other as resources and share the weight of running an institution. In their team, everyone counts and has a voice, from the person who cooks and washes to the receptionist and the group of directors. There is a space for sharing and hearing each other out, and this is something they apply in the way they direct and run their institution. Coffee with the Team is inspired by this practice, and it is a series of gatherings where the team at Hordaland Kunstsenter sits around a coffee table. Together we share food and coffee, and it has been an initiative to create a space to sit together and share ideas, get to know each other, learn about what each person does, and look at the future and the past of the institution together. Not everyone is present all the time, but everyone is invited. It has become a way to take care of each other and share the burden. It is an open forum for ideas and suggestions, as well as collective brainstorming. The time used on these meetings is paid, so it's seen as valuable time given to the institution from the employees. And it will continue to be a part of the permanent program at Hordaland Kunstsenter as an important resource for the team. We do it once a month. The next project is Nunes Trolls. Nunes Trolls was a project conceived by artist and educator Marina Echegoyen and artist Lucila Mayol. Both Lucila and Marina are from Argentina and met in Buenos Aires many years ago. They kept collaborating at a distance in different projects, including a neighborhood project in Helsinki, where Maria created an alternative map that would guide people between two neighborhoods and find new spots for encounters and interactions. Inspired by this project, I invited Lucila and Marina to bring a proposal that would connect Hordaland Kunstsenter to the neighborhood and the neighbors to Hordaland Kunstsenter. Their suggestion was Nunes Trolls, a project in four stages where the artists invited especially people living in the area to join and explore the neighborhood of Nunes together. Nunes Trolls was a series of walks that explore the neighborhood through history, listening exercises, and games. Each walk had a specific theme, and it ended up gathering the experiences in a small publication. Here is Lucila, and in the table on the back, you see the small publications on a very cold December day. And this is part of the publication, illustrated by Marina. Now I'm going to show you the workshops with Noam Edelman-Chatil. This project looked at the work of the Mexican collective La Hervidera. As a group, they explore the cognitive possibilities of art, looking at it through an interdisciplinary lens where the body is at the center of the practice, allowing the participants to of their workshops to feel, touch, move, and use their senses in order to find new entry points. To approach the exhibition program at the Arts Center, I wanted to find alternative ways of looking at the work presented, but also at the institution. I invited dancer Noam Edelman-Shatil to collaborate. Noam is a dancer and educator from Israel. She is a part of the Norwegian company of contemporary dance Carte de Blanche, which is also based in Nunes, the neighborhood where the Art Center is located. I presented Noam with the work of La Hervidera and how I wanted to translate their methods into a workshop that would fit into the local context. We worked together on two occasions, one workshop during the summer and one during the autumn of 2020. The summer workshop was called In Subterranea. In this workshop, Noam invited the participants to explore artists Lene Bodsvig Ørmen's exhibition Subterranea through a series of physical movements and visual exercises that will allow them to experiment and engage with the sculptures, the room, the shapes and textures, and the narrative of the exhibition through the body. The autumn exhibition was called Inside, Outside, and 2 meters Apart. Noam invited the participants to explore and appropriate the space at Hordaland Kunstsenter through a series of physical and sensory exercises that allowed them to experience and engage with the architecture, the rooms, and the significance of being at an empty gallery space. There was no exhibition happening at this time, so it was empty of art. Yeah, so and the significance, so exploring the architecture, the rooms, and the significance of being at an empty art gallery, finding new narratives and stories. The workshop guided the bodies into finding closeness and intimacy, keeping distance and restraint as we were facing the pandemics, of course. In each of the workshops, as well as you could see on one of the past images, it was important to gather after in conversation around the table, sharing a bite and a warm beverage and digesting the experience together. Noam baked delicious cakes and we had warm beverages where we could sit and be cozy. The conversations were crucial and it was the moment where we became micro communities. We all shared an experience and each felt it differently. The feedback from the participants was that being able to enter what otherwise is a very restricted experience, we don't usually touch or get too close or even move too sudden inside of an art gallery, made them feel free and free themselves of preconceived notions of how we are supposed to look at art, and instead start from a physical perspective, allowing the intellectual to come after. We felt first, and then we thought. Kjære nabo, or dear neighbor, is the next project. And with dear neighbor, I wanted to approach the new situation we found us in last spring with the pandemic. In the beginning of the pandemic, and we began to see the effects of social distance, closing of institutions, and a large response with digital mediation. All of this felt overwhelming, and I instead wanted to take a different and more intimate approach. Instead of focusing on reaching out to thousands, I was interested in creating connections with people directly, and a letter felt like the right approach. I wanted to find a way that felt more intimate and that focused on the 100 meters around the block of the Art Center. So Dear Neighbor is a collection of letters that are sent to people living in the vicinity of the Art Center. For each installment, an artist is commissioned to look at the format of the letter and create work that responds to this idea. The first artist commissioned was Nayara Leite, She is a Brazilian visual artist based in Bergen, whose practice navigates between analog photography, performance, text, installation, and video. Nayara has used the format of the letter as a way of connecting with her country, her friends, her politics, and making herself more present and actively involved with the Brazilian LGBTQ plus issues that are so close to her heart. For Dear Neighbor, Nayara takes her research involvement and activism into a local context and looks at the queer history of Nunes, the neighborhood where Art Center is located, in close collaboration with Shaved Arkiv, which is the Norwegian National Archive for Queer and LGBT History. As a result, she produced a series of three fanzines with the title Femme Tusen of Femme, or 5005. The fanzines present historical facts, some situated in the neighborhood of Nunes, as well as contemporary issues happening with the world today. 5005 is the postcode for the Arts Center. Nayara delivered 100 fanzines of each edition to the post boxes, to random post boxes with this postcode. The last fanzine was delivered in late June, and as a closing for the project, Nayara organized a karaoke night for the neighbors and people that would like to join and sing together at Hordaland Kunstsenter. So all these words that you see on your screen are words that I carry with me when I am thinking about projects, when I'm thinking about mediating or creating opportunities for people to meet. I find them very important in my practice, and I keep adding to this list. So if you have any words that you want to share with me that I should consider, I would really love to hear them. But for me, these are maybe the most important ones. And then from there, I think of ideas and I think of projects and I start making connections. So thank you so much for listening to me. These were only very quick presentations on each of the projects. I could speak very much longer on each of them. Please contact me if you have any questions, if you want to know more, if you need a link that I forgot. I think I forgot to link Teoretica at some point, but I will share all these links with you. I also forgot to link my own organizations, but I will share those with you as well. And keep in touch. I am now going to move on to what the creative task will be. And I know you will be working on this after you see this presentation. And I know we will also have a time to chat and talk. So if you have any questions after you read this, please let me know. So the creative task is, what do you want to learn? What do you want to teach? So this is an exercise made by La Agencia, which is a collective based in Bogota, Colombia. And I really recommend that you check their website, and they also have a really nice Instagram that I can pass you later on as well. So what do you want to learn? What do you want to teach? The first part of the instructions is, in front of you, you will find a large paper and pen. At this point, everyone will be sitting on a circle, either on the floor or around the table. I'm not sure how things will be arranged in each of your spaces, but please sit around the table so that you can all be connected. And then the next part is looking at the questions. What do you want to learn? What do you want to teach? Think about these two questions and write your answers on the large paper in front of you. You can have more than one answer because that is okay. You will use 10 minutes on this part of the activity. And please don't restrict yourselves to be super over intellectual. This is not about that. This is not about your field. This is not about art. This is not about whatever you're working on right now, it is open to that, but it is about what you want. So what do you want to learn? What do you want to teach? For example, I want to learn how to speak French well, and I would like to teach someone to make corn tortillas, for example. As simple as that. Or these are things that I actually really want to learn or teach. Or, for example, if you want to go deeper into your own work or experience, I would like to learn how to balance work and family life better. And I would like to teach how to breathe when you're having stress, a stressful moment. So yes, things like that, you can be as open and you can write many things. 10 minutes, I think it's a small or large amount of time, but let's keep it there. Then for the next part, you will have 45 minutes, and this is mapping. And this is when we share. Share your answers with the rest of the group. Go in a circle, like each of you can read one by one, following the circle or whatever, however you decide to do it. Read your answers out loud one by one. Do you have any things in common? Is your own list growing? Are you finding compatible partners to either learn from or teach to? As a group, look at each other's answers and see if you can link any of them. Use this time to listen to each other, to tell each other about your wishes. So at this time, you can be very open, very playful. You can have conversations because you will find those intersections, and you can even draw lines on the paper to connect each other. So be creative, feel free, own the paper, own your wishes. And now after this 45 minutes, you will have a 10-minute break. For the second part, you will divide in groups of three. So for example, if you're 10 people, please make two groups of three, one group of four. Each group will pick one answer from the large paper, just to make clear, one answer for each question. So what do you want to learn? What do you want to teach? Pick one of each in consensus. With these answers, each group will develop a proposal for mediating them to the rest of the group. Remember, think with your bodies and minds, be disobedient, break the rules, improvise, think outside the box. How would you communicate, share, interpret these wishes with your peers? And this is a prototype, it's abstract. So you will find a way to make your wish a bit of a fiction or reality. So it is up to you. You will be very flexible. You use the time that you need, and find a time as with the rest of the groups where you will gather again. So for example, if you decide to meet again at 5 o'clock, then everyone will be able to have a time to finish. But yes, you decide together when you want to meet again. And if you need more time, talk to each other. So yes, so this part is, as you can read, flexible, use the time you need, but find a time that suits everyone to meet again and share your experiences. Each group will have in the end 10 minutes to present their projects. So as a proposal, I hope that after you have had a time to present your projects in the end, that you can sit around together as a group and reflect. Hopefully you can find a warm beverage and sit around the table and maybe have a little bite. And I do believe that this really gives us an opportunity to relax, to breathe, and to sit together. Jump a little bit around, up and down, just break the stiffness of having to think too much. Maybe just make some funny noises, whatever makes you break the cycle and start again. And then when you start again, use this time to think together and reflect. I would really like you to think about your experience, think about this exercise and how you would include it and show it to somebody else. if you think this is something you would like to do again, and if you feel that mediation is something that can be included in other things besides art and, I don't know, education. How do you see mediation as a group? How do you see mediation as an individual? Those are my two questions. I didn't write them down here, but yes. Maybe with your reflection, think of those two. How do you see mediation as a group? How do you see mediation as an individual? Thank you so much for today and hope to talk to you soon. I look forward to hear about your experiences. Bye.